Act One, Scene One, Rome, a public place. It is a festive, sunshiny day, and a crowd of common people are gathered here. Two tribunes enter, Flavius and Marullus.
Hence, home, you idle creatures. Get you home. Is this a holiday? What, though you're not being mechanical, you ought not walk upon a laboring day without the sign of your profession? Speak, what trade art thou?
Why, sir, a carpenter.
Where is thy leather apron and thy rule? What dost thou with thy best apparel on?
He wheels about and waves at another.
You, sir, what trade are you?
The commoner bows low, his eyes twinkling.
A trade, sir, that I hope I may use with a safe conscience, which is indeed, sir, a mender of bad souls.
What trade, thou knave, thou naughty knave, what trade?
Nay, I beseech you, sir, be not out with me. Yet if you be out, sir, I can mend you.
What meanst thou by that? Mend me, thou saucy fellow.
Why, sir, cobble you.
What a cobbler art thou.
I am indeed, sir, a surgeon to old shoes.
But wherefore art not in thy shop today? Why dost thou leave these men about the street?
Truly, sir, to wear out their shoes to get myself into more work. But indeed, sir, we make holiday to see Caesar and to rejoice in his triumph.
Wherefore rejoice? What conquest brings he home? What tributaries follow him to Rome? You blocks, you stones, you worse than senseless things. You, you not Pompey! Many a time and oft have you climbed up to walls and battlements, to towers and windows, yea, to chimney tops, your infants in your arms, and there have sat the livelong day with patient expectation to see great Pompey pass the streets of Rome. And do you now put on your best attire? And do you now call out a holiday? And do you now strew flowers in his way that comes in triumph of a Pompey's blood? Begone! Run to your houses, fall upon your knees, pray to the gods to intermit the plague that needs must light on this ingratitude.
Go, go, good countrymen.
The crowd scatters and moves down the street. The two tribunes watch them as they hurry off.
They vanish tongue-tied in their guiltiness. Go you down that way towards the Capitol. This way will I. Disrobe the images if you do find them decked with ceremonies.
May we do so. You know it is the Feast of Lupercal.
It is no matter. Let no images be hung with Caesar's trophies. I'll about and drive away the vulgar from the streets. So do you, too, where you perceive them thick. These growing feathers plucked from Caesar's wing will make him fly an ordinary pitch. Who else would soar above the view of men and keep us all in servile fearfulness?
Saluting, the tribunes exit in different directions. The noise of the approaching parade grows in volume. Crowds back up the street crying excitedly and waving. Soldiers appear and clear them from the road. Julius Caesar appears, followed by his train. Calpurnia, Portia, Mark Antony, Cicero, Decius, Brutus, Cassius, and Casca. More commoners follow after them until the stage is choked with people.
Calpurnia, cease home! Caesar, speak!
Calpurnia.
Here, my lord.
Send you directly in Antonius' way when he doth run his course. Antonius?
Caesar, my lord.
Forget not in your speed, Antonius, to touch Calpurnia. For our elders say the baron touched in this holy chase shake off their sterile curse.
I shall remember. When Caesar says do this, it is performed.
Set on, and leave no ceremony out.
Caesar!
Huh? Who calls?
Bid every noise be still! Peace yet again!
Who is it in the press that calls on me? I hear a tongue shriller than all the music cry, Caesar,
Caesar,
speak! Caesar is turned to hear.
Beware the Ides of March.
What man is that?
A soothsayer bid you beware the Ides of March.
Set him before me. Let me see his face.
Hello, come from the throng. Look upon Caesar.
What sayest thou to me now? Speak once again.
Beware the Ides of March.
He is a dreamer. Let us leave him. Pass.
The procession moves off. Cassius looks across to Brutus, standing alone at the other side of the stage, engrossed in thought. When the others have gone, he calls over to him.
Will you go see the order of the course?
Not I.
I pray you do.
I am not gamesome. I do lack some part of that quick spirit that is in Antony. Let me not hinder, Cassius, your desires. I'll leave you.
Brutus, I do observe you now of late. I have not from your eyes that gentleness and show of love as I was wont to have. You bear too stubborn and too strange a hand over your friend that loves you.
Cassius, be not deceived. If I have veiled my look, I turn the trouble of my countenance merely upon myself. Vexed I am of late with passions of some difference, conceptions only proper to myself, which give some soil, perhaps, to my behaviors.
Then, Brutus, I have much mistook your passion. Tell me, good Brutus, can you see your face?
No, Cassius, for the eye sees not itself, but by reflection, by some other things.
'Tis just. And it is very much lamented, Brutus, that you have no such mirrors as will turn your hidden worthiness into your eye, that you might see your shadow. I have heard where many of the best respect in Rome, except immortal Caesar, speaking of Brutus and groaning underneath this age's yoke, have wished that noble Brutus had his eyes.
Into what dangers would you lead me, Cassius? That you would have me seek into myself for that which is not in me.
Therefore, good Brutus, be prepared to hear. And since you know you cannot see yourself so well as by reflection, I, your glass, will modestly discover to yourself that of yourself which you yet know not of. And be not jealous of me, gentle Brutus. Were I a common laugher, or did use to stale with ordinary oaths my love to every new protester, if you know that I do fawn on men and hug them hard and after scandal them, or if you know that I profess myself in banqueting to all the rout, then hold me dangerous.
What means this shouting? I do fear the people choose Caesar for their king.
Aye? Do you fear it? Then must I think you would not have it so.
I would not, Cassius. Yet I love him well. But wherefore do you hold me here so long? What is it that you would impart to me? If it be aught toward the general good, set honor in one eye and death in the other, and I will look on both indifferently. For let the gods so speed me as I love the name of honor more than I fear death.
I know that virtue to be in you, Brutus, as well as I do know your outward favor. Well, honor is the subject of my story. I cannot tell what you and other men think of this life, but for my single self, I had as lief not be as live to be in awe of such a thing as I myself. I was born free as Caesar. So were you. We both are fed as well, and we can both endure the winter's cold as well as he. For once, upon a raw and gusty day, the troubled Tiber chafing with her shores, Caesar said to me, "Darest thou, Cassius, now leap in with me into this angry flood and swim to yonder point?" Upon the word, accoutred as I was, I plunged in and bade him follow, so indeed he did. The torrent roared. We did buffet it, with lusty sinews throwing it aside and stemming it with hearts of controversy. But ere we could arrive the point proposed, Caesar cried, "Help me, Cassius, or I sink." I, as Aeneas, our great ancestor, did from the flames of Troy upon his shoulder the old Anchises bear, so from the waves of Tiber did I the tyrant Caesar. And this man is now become a god, and Cassius is a wretched creature and must bend his body if Caesar carelessly but nod on him. He had a fever when he was in Spain, and when the fit was on him, I did mark how he did shake. 'Tis true, this god did shake. His coward lips did from their color fly, and that same eye, whose bendeth o'er the world, did lose his luster. I did hear him groan, aye, and that tongue of his that bade the Romans mark him and write his speeches in their books. Alas, it cried, give me some drink, Titinius, as a sick girl. Ye gods, it have amazed me. A man of such a feeble temper should so get the start of the majestic world and bear the palm alone.
Another general shout. I do believe that these applauses are for some new honors that are heaped on Caesar.
Why, man, he doth bestride the narrow world like a colossus. And we, petty men, walk under his huge legs and peep about to find ourselves dishonorable graves. Men at some time are masters of their fates. The fault, dear Brutus, is not in our stars, but in ourselves that we are underlings. Brutus and Caesar, what should be in that Caesar? Why should that name be sounded more than yours? Write them together. Yours is as fair a name.
Sound them, it doth become the mouth as well. Weigh them, it is as heavy. Conjure with them, Brutus will start a spirit as soon as Caesar. Now, in the names of all the gods at once, upon what meat doth this our Caesar feed that he has grown so great? Age, thou art shamed. Rome, thou hast lost the breed of noble bloods. When could they say till now that talked of Rome, that her wide walls encompass but one man? Oh, you and I have heard our fathers say, there was a Brutus once that would have brooked the eternal devil to keep his state in Rome as easily as a king.
That you do love me, I am nothing jealous. What you would work me to, I have some aim. How I have thought of this and of these times, I shall recount hereafter. Till then, my noble friend, chew upon this. Brutus had rather be a villager than to repute himself a son of Rome under these hard conditions as this time is like to lay upon us.
I am glad that my weak words have struck but thus much show of fire from Brutus.
The games are done and Caesar is returning.
They pass by, pluck Casca by the sleeve. And he will, after his sour fashion, tell you what hath proceeded worthy note today.
I will do so. But look you, Cassius. The angry spot doth glow on Caesar's brow, and all the rest look like a chidden train.
Casca will tell us what the matter is.
Antonius.
Caesar, my lord.
Let me have men about me that are fat. Sleek-headed men, and such as sleep o' nights. Yon Cassius has a lean and hungry look. He thinks too much. Such men are dangerous.
Fear him not, Caesar. He's not dangerous. He's a noble Roman and well given.
Would he were fatter. But I fear him not. Yet if my name were liable to fear, I do not know the man I should avoid so soon as that fair Cassius. He reads much. He is a great observer. And he looks quite through the deeds of men. He loves no plays as thou dost, Antony. He hears no music. Seldom he smiles, and smiles in such a sort as if he mocked himself, and scorned his spirit that could be moved to smile at anything. Such men as he be never at heart's ease whilst they behold a greater than themselves, and therefore are they very dangerous. I rather tell thee what is to be feared than what I fear, for always I am Caesar. Come on my right hand, for this here is death. And tell me truly what thou thinkst of him.
Exit Caesar and his train, Casca remaining behind.
You pulled me by the cloak. Would you speak with me?
Aye, Casca. Tell us what hath chanced today that Caesar looks so sad.
Why, there was a crown offered him, and being offered him, he put it by with the back of his hand, thus. And then the people fell a-shouting.
What was the second noise for?
Why, for that, too.
They shouted thrice. What was the last cry for?
Why, for that, too.
Was the crown offered him thrice?
Aye, and they put it by thrice, every time gentler than the other, and at every putting by, mine honest neighbor shouted.
Who offered him the crown?
Why, Antony.
Tell us the manner of it, gentle Casca.
I can as well be hanged as tell the manner of it. It was mere foolery. I did not mark it. I saw Mark Antony offer him a crown, yet 'twas not a crown, neither 'twas one of these coronets. And as I told you, he put it by once. But for all that, to my thinking, he would fain have had it. Then he offered it to him again. And then he put it by again. And then he offered it the third time. And still as he refused it, the rabblemen shouted and clapped their chopped hands and threw up their sweaty nightcaps and uttered such a deal of stinking breath because Caesar refused the crown that it had almost choked Caesar, for he swooned it and fell down at it. For mine own part, I durst not laugh for fear of opening my lips and receiving the bad air.
But soft, I pray you. What, did Caesar swound?
He fell down in the marketplace and foamed at the mouth and was speechless.
'Tis very like he hath the falling sickness.
No, Caesar hath it not, but you and I and honest Casca, we have the falling sickness.
What said he when he came unto himself?
Mary, before he fell down, when he perceived the common herd was glad he refused the crown, he plucked me ope his doublet and offered them his throat to cut. And I had been a man of any occupation, if I would not have taken but a word, I might go to hell among the rogues. And so he fell. When he came to himself again, he said if he had done or said anything amiss, he desired their worships to think it was his infirmity. Three or four wenches where I stood cried, alas, good soul, and forgave him with all their hearts. But there's no heed to be taken of them. If Caesar'd stabbed their mothers, they'd have done no less.
And after that he came thus sad away?
Aye.
Did Cicero say anything?
Aye, he spoke Greek.
To what effect?
Nay, and I tell you that, I'll ne'er look you in the face again. But those that understood him smiled at one another and shook their heads. But for mine own part, it was Greek to me. I could tell you more news, too. Marullus and Flavius, for pulling scarfs off Caesar's images, are put to silence. Fare you well. There was more foolery yet, if I could remember it.
Will you sup with me tonight, Casca?
No, I'm promised for.
Will you dine with me tomorrow?
Aye, if I be alive and your mind hold and your dinner worth the eating.
Good. I'll expect you.
Do so. Farewell, both.
Exit, Casca.
What a blunt fellow is this grown to be. He was quick metal when he went to school.
So is he now in execution of any bold or noble enterprise, however he puts on this tardy form. This rudeness is a sauce to his good wit, which gives men stomach to digest his words with better appetite.
And so it is. For this time, I will leave you. Tomorrow, if you please to speak with me, I will come home to you. Or if you will, come home to me, and I will wait for you.
I will do so. Till then, think of the world. Exit Brutus. Cassius stands looking after his retreating figure. Well, Brutus, thou art noble. Yet I see thy honorable metal may be wrought from that it is disposed. Therefore, 'tis meet that noble minds keep ever with their likes. For who so firm that cannot be seduced? Caesar doth bear me hard, but he loves Brutus. If I were Brutus now and he were Cassius, he should not humor me. I will this night in several hands in at his windows throw, as if they came from several citizens, writings all tending to the great opinion that Rome holds of his name, wherein obscurely Caesar's ambition shall be glanced at. And after this, let Caesar seat him sure, for we will shake him, or worse days endure. Act 1, Scene 2, Rome, a street. 'Tis the eve of the Ides of March. A month has elapsed since first Cassius approached Brutus. A terrible night. Driving rain and violent thunder and lightning. As the curtain rises, Cassius is discovered near the center, probably taking refuge under some form of shelter. Casca hurries up to him.
Who's there?
A Roman.
Casca, by your voice.
Your ear is good. Cassius, what night is this?
A very pleasing night to honest men.
Whoever knew the heavens menace so?
Those that have known the earth so full of faults.
Are you not moved when all the sway of earth shakes like a thing unfirm? Oh, Cassius, I have seen tempests when the scolding winds have rived the knotty oaks, and I have seen the ambitious ocean swell and rage and foam to be exalted with the threatening clouds. But never till tonight, never till now, did I go through a tempest-dropping fire. Either there is a civil strife in heaven, or else the world, too saucy with the gods, incenses them to send destruction.
Now could I, Casca, name to thee a man most like this dreadful night. A man no mightier than thyself or me in personal action, yet prodigious grown and fearful as these strange eruptions are.
Indeed, they say the senators tomorrow mean to establish Caesar as a king, and he shall wear his crown by sea and land in every place save here in Italy.
I know where I will wear this dagger then. Cassius from bondage will deliver Cassius. That part of tyranny that I do bear I can shake off at pleasure.
So can I.
And why should Caesar be a tyrant then? Poor man. I know he would not be a wolf, but that he sees the Romans are but sheep. He were no lion, were not Romans, hinds. Enter Cinna.
Stand close a while, for here comes one in haste.
To Cinna. I do know him by his gait. He is a friend.
Cinna! Where haste you so?
Find you out. Who's that? Metellus Timber?
No. It is Casca. One incorporate to our attempts. Am I not stayed for, Cinna?
I am glad, aunt. What a fearful night is this. As two or three of us have seen strange sights.
Am I not stayed for? Tell me.
Yes. Who are? Oh, Cassius, if you could but win the noble Brutus to our party.
Be you content. Good sinner, take this paper and look you lay it in the praetor's chair where Brutus may but find it. And throw this in at his window. Set this up with wax upon old Brutus' statue. All this done, repair to Pompey's porch where you shall find us. Is Decius, Brutus, and Trebonius there?
All but Metellus Cimber, and he's gone to seek you at your house. Well, I will hie and so bestow these papers as you bade me.
That done, repair to Pompey Theater. Exit, Cinna. Come, Casca. You and I will yet ere day see Brutus at his house. Three parts of him is ours already. And the man in Tyre upon the next encounter yields him ours.
Oh, he sits high in all the people's hearts. And that which would appear offense in us, his countenance, like richest alchemy, will change to virtue and to worthiness.
Him and his worth and our great need of him, you have right well conceded. Let us go. It is after midnight. And ere day, we will awake him and be sure of him. Act Two, Scene One. Rome, Brutus Orchard. Brutus comes down center, looks anxiously about him and up at the sky. Then he calls his serving boy.
What, Lucius? Oh!
I cannot, by the progress of the stars, give guess how near today.
Lucius, I say!
I would it were my fault to sleep so soundly.
When, Lucius? When? Awake, I say! What, Lucius?
Enter, Lucius.
Call you, my lord?
Get me a taper in my study, Lucius. When it is lighted, come and call me here.
I will, my lord.
Exit, Lucius. Brutus is alone in his garden. He speaks his thoughts.
It must be by his death. And for my part, I know no personal cause to spurn at him. But for the general, he would be crowned. How that might change his nature. There's the question. It is the bright day that brings forth the adder and that craves wary walking. Crown him. That. And then I grant we put a sting in him that at his will he may do danger with. The abuse of greatness is when it disjoins remorse from power. And to speak truth of Caesar, I have not known when his affections swayed more than his reason. But 'tis a common proof that lowliness is young ambition's ladder, whereto the climber upward turns his face. But when once he attains the utmost round, he then unto the ladder turns his back, looks in the clouds, scorning the base degrees by which he did ascend. So Caesar may. Then, lest he may, prevent.
Re-enter Lucius.
The taper burneth in your closet, sir. Searching the window for a flint, I found this paper thus sealed up. And I'm sure it did not lie there when I went to bed.
Get you to bed again. It is not day.
Lucius starts to go.
Is not tomorrow, boy, the Ides of March?
I know not, sir.
Look in the calendar and bring me word.
I will, sir.
Lucius exits. Brutus opens the letter.
The exhalations whizzing in the air give so much light that I may read by them. Brutus, thou sleepst. Awake and see thyself. Shall Rome, etc. Speak, strike, redress. Brutus, thou sleepst. Awake. Such instigations have been often dropped where I've took them up. Shall Rome, etc. Thus must I piece it out. Shall Rome stand under one man's awe? What? Rome? My ancestors did from the streets of Rome the Tarquin drive when he was called a king. Speak, strike, redress. Am I entreated to speak and strike? O Rome, I make thee promise, if the redress will follow, thou receivest thy full petition at the hand of Brutus.
Re-enter Lucius.
Sir, March has wasted 14 days.
It is good. Go to the gate. Somebody knocks.
Exit Lucius.
Since Cassius first did wet me against Caesar, I have not slept. Between the acting of a dreadful thing and the first motion, all the interim is like a phantasma or a hideous dream. The genius and the mortal instruments are then in council. And the state of man, like to a little kingdom, suffers then the nature of an insurrection.
Re-enter Lucius.
Sir, is your brother Cassius at the door, who doth desire to see you.
Is he alone?
No, sir, there are more with him.
You know them?
No, sir. Their hats are plucked about their ears, and half their faces buried in their cloaks, that by no means I may discover them by any mark of favor.
Adamantha.
Exit Lucius.
They are the faction. O conspiracy, shamest thou to show thy dangerous brow by night, when evils are most free. Oh, then by day, where wilt thou find that cavern dark enough?
The conspirators appear at the entrance. Cassius comes forward.
I think we are too bold upon your rest. Good morrow, Brutus. Do we trouble you?
I've been up this hour, awake all night. Know I these men that come along with you?
Yes, every man of them. This is Trebonius.
He is welcome hither.
This Decius Brutus.
He is welcome too.
This Casca, this Cinna, and this Metella Simba.
They are all welcome. What watchful cares do interpose themselves betwixt your eyes and night?
Shall I entreat a word? Brutus and Cassius go off a little in the garden and whisper together. The others stir uneasily and manufacture some conversation about the weather.
Here lies the east. Does not the day break here?
No.
Oh, pardon, sir, it does. Yon gray lines that fret the clouds are messengers of day.
You shall confess that you're both deceived. Here, as I point my sword, the sun arises.
Brutus rejoins the group.
Give me your hands all over, one by one.
And let us swear our resolution.
No. Not an oath. If not the face of men, the sufferance of our souls, the time's abuse, if these be motives weak, break off betimes, and every man hence to his idle bed. What need we any spur but our own cause to prick us to redress, when every drop of blood that every Roman bears and nobly bears is guilty of a several bastardy, if he do break the smallest particle of any promise that hath passed from him?
Shall no man else be touched but only Caesar?
Decius, well urged. I think it is not meet Mark Antony, so well beloved of Caesar, should outlive Caesar. Let Antony and Caesar fall together.
Our course will seem too bloody, Caius Cassius, to cut the head off and then hack the limbs, like wrath in death and envy afterwards. For Antony is but a limb of Caesar. Let us be sacrificers, but not butchers, Caius. We all stand up against the spirit of Caesar. And in the spirit of men, there is no blood. Oh, that we could come by Caesar's spirit and not dismember Caesar. But alas, Caesar must bleed for it. And gentle friends, let's kill him boldly, but not wrathfully. Let's carve him as a dish fit for the gods, not hew him as a carcass fit for hounds. And for Mark Antony, think not of him, for he can do no more than Caesar's arm when Caesar's head is off.
Yet I fear him, for in the engrafted love he bears to Caesar...
Peace. Count the clock.
Clock has stricken three.
It's time to part.
But it is doubtful yet whether Caesar will come forth today or no. For he is superstitious grown of late. It may be these apparent prodigies, the unaccustomed terror of this night and the persuasion of his augurers may hold him from the capital today.
Never fear that. If he be so resolved, I can o'ersway him. Let me work. For I can give his humor the true bent, and I will bring him to the capital.
Nay, we will all of us be there to fetch him. Cassius and the others start to leave.
By the eighth hour? Is that the uttermost?
Be that the uttermost, and fail not then.
Exit the conspirators. Brutus turns, facing the audience, and sighs thoughtfully. Dawn is showing in the sky. Waking out of his reverie, he calls,
Boy! Lucius! Fast to speak. It is no matter. Enjoy the honey-heavy dew of slumber. Thou hast no figures, nor no fantasies, which busy care draws in the brains of men. Therefore thou sleep so sound.
Enter Portia.
Brutus, my lord.
Portia, what mean you? Wherefore rise you now? Tis not for your health thus to commit your weak condition to the raw cold morning.
Nor for yours neither. You've ungently, Brutus, stole from my bed. And yesternight at supper you suddenly arose and walked about, musing and sighing with your arms across. And when I asked you what the matter was, you stared at me. Ungentle looks and with an angry watcher of your hand gave sign for me to leave you. So I did, hoping it was an effect of humor which sometimes has its hour with every man. It will not let you eat, nor talk, nor sleep. And could it work so much upon your shape as it has much prevailed on your condition, I should not know you, Brutus. Dear my lord, make me acquainted with your cause of grief.
I am not well in health, and that is all.
Brutus is wise. And were he not in health, he would embrace the means to come by it.
Why, so I do. Good, Portia. Go to bed.
Is Brutus sick? And is it physical to walk unbraced and suck up the humors of the dank morning? No, my Brutus. You have some sick offense within your mind, which by the right and virtue of my place I ought to know of. Within the bond of marriage, tell me, Brutus, is it accepted I should know no secrets that appertain to you? Am I yourself but, as it were, in sort or limitation, to keep with you at meals, comfort your bed, and talk to you sometimes? Dwell I but in the suburbs of your good pleasure? If it be no more, Portia, Brutus harlot, not his wife.
You are my true and honorable wife.
If this were true, then should I know this secret. I grant I'm a woman, but with all a woman that Lord Brutus took to wife. I grant I'm a woman, but with all a woman well reputed, Cato's daughter. Think you I'm no stronger than my sex, being so fathered and so husbanded? Tell me your counsels. I will not disclose them. I've made strong proof of my constancy, giving myself a voluntary wound here in the thigh. Can I bear that with patience, and not my husband's secret?
Oh, ye gods, render me worthy of this noble wife. Hark, hark, one knocks. Portia, go in a while, and by thy bosom shall partake the secrets of my heart. All my engagements I will construe to thee, all the charactery of my sad brows. Leave me with haste. Lucius, who's that knocks?
Portia turns and goes into the house. Enter Lucius.
Man that would speak with you.
Enter Ligarius.
Chaos Ligarius? Boy, stand aside.
Vouchsafe good morrow from a feeble tongue.
Oh, what a time have you chose out, brave Chaos, to wear a kerchief. Would you are not sick?
I am not sick if Brutus have in hand any exploit worthy the name of honor.
Such an exploit have I in hand, Ligarius. Had you a healthful ear, hear of it.
By all the gods that Romans bow before, I here discard my sickness. Soul of Rome, brave son, derived from honorable loins, thou, like an exorcist, hast conjured up my mortified spirit. Now bid me run, and I will strive with things impossible, yea, get the better of them. What's to do?
A piece of work that will make sick men whole.
But are not some whole that we must make sick?
That must be also. What it is, my cares, I shall unfold to thee as we are going, to whom it must be done.
Set on your foot, and with a heart new fired, I follow you to do I know not what, but it sufficeth that Brutus leads me on.
Follow me, then.
Act 2, Scene 2, Caesar's House. It is now several hours since the meeting of the conspirators in Brutus's orchard, the morning of the Ides of March. Outside, it's raining again, and there's the sound of thunder. Enter Caesar.
Nor heaven nor earth have been at peace tonight. Thrice hath Calpurnia in her sleep cried out, "Help, ho, they murder Caesar."
Who's within?
Enter a servant.
My lord? Go bid the priests do present sacrifice and bring me their opinion of success.
I will, my lord.
Exit the servant. Enter Calpurnia.
What mean you, Caesar? Think you to walk forth? You shall not stir out of your house today.
Caesar shall forth. The things that threatened me ne'er looked but on my back. When they shall see the face of Caesar, they are vanished.
Caesar, I never stood on ceremonies, yet now they fright me. There is one within, besides the things that we have heard and seen, recounts most horrid sights seen by the watch. A lioness hath whelped in the streets, and graves have yawned and yielded up their dead. Fierce, fiery warriors fought upon the clouds in ranks and squadrons and right form of war, which drizzled blood upon the capital. The noise of battle hurtled in the air. Horses did neigh, and dying men did groan, and ghosts did shriek and squeal about the streets. Oh, Caesar, these things are beyond all use, and I do fear them.
What can be avoided whose end is purposed by the mighty gods? Yet Caesar shall go forth. For these predictions are to the world in general as to Caesar.
When beggars die, there are no comets seen. The heavens themselves blaze forth the death of princes.
Cowards die many times before their deaths. The valiant never taste of death but once. Of all the wonders that I yet have heard, It seems to me most strange that men should fear, seeing that death, a necessary end, will come when it will come.
Enter the servant.
What say the augurers?
They would not have you to stir forth today. Plucking the entrails of an offering forth, they could not find a heart within the beast.
The gods do this in shame of cowardice. Caesar should be a beast without a heart if he should stay at home today for fear. No, Caesar shall not. Danger knows full well that Caesar is more dangerous than he. We are two lions littered in one day, and I the elder and more terrible. And Caesar shall go forth.
Alas, my lord, your wisdom is consumed in confidence. Do not go forth today. Call it my fear that keeps you in the house and not your own. We'll send Mark Antony to the Senate House, and he shall say you are not well today. Let me upon my knee prevail in this.
Mark Antony shall say I am not well. And for thy humor, I will stay at home.
Enter Decius.
Here's Decius Brutus. He shall tell them so.
Caesar, all hail. Tomorrow, worthy Caesar, I come to fetch you to the Senate House.
And you are come in very happy time to bear my greetings to the senators and tell them that I will not come today. Cannot is false, and that I dare not falser. I will not come today. Tell them so, Decius.
Say he is sick.
Shall Caesar send a lie? Have I, in conquest, stretched mine arm so far to be afeard to tell Greybeards the truth? Decius, go tell them. Caesar will not come.
Most mighty Caesar, let me know some cause, lest I be laughed at when I tell them so.
The cause is in my will. I will not come. That is enough to satisfy the Senate. But for your private satisfaction, because I love you, I will let you know. Calpurnia here, my wife, stays me at home. She dreamt tonight she saw my statua, which like a fountain with 100 spouts did run pure blood, and many lusty Romans came smiling and did bathe their hands in it. And these doth she apply for warnings and portents and evils imminent, and on her knee hath begged that I will stay at home today.
This dream is all amiss interpreted. It was a vision fair and fortunate. Your statue spouting blood in many pipes in which so many smiling Romans bathe signifies that from you great Rome shall suck reviving blood, and that great men shall press for tinctures, stains, relics, and cognizance. This by Calpurnia's dream is signified.
And this way have you well expounded it.
I have, when you have heard what I can say. And know it now. The Senate have concluded to give this day a crown to mighty Caesar. If you shall send them word you will not come, their minds may change. Besides, it were a mark apt to be rendered for someone to say, break up the Senate till another time when Caesar's wife shall meet with better dreams. If Caesar hide himself, shall they not whisper, lo, Caesar is afraid. Pardon me, Caesar. For my dear, dear love to your proceeding bids me tell you this.
How foolish do your fears seem now, Calpurnia. I am ashamed I did yield to them. Give me my robe, for I will go.
Decius darts a quick look of triumph at the heartbroken Calpurnia. As the servant is dressing Caesar in his robe of state, the conspirators and Publius enter.
And look where Publius has come to fetch me.
Good morrow, Caesar.
Welcome, Publius. What, Brutus?
Caesar?
Are you stirred so early, too? Good morrow, Casca. Caius Ligarius. Caesar was ne'er so much your enemy as that same ague which hath made you lean. What is the clock?
Caesar, it is striking 8.
I thank you for your pains and courtesy.
Enter Mark Antony.
See, Antony, that revels longer nights, is not withstanding up. Good morrow, Antony.
So to most noble Caesar.
Bid them prepare within. I am to blame to be thus waited for. Now, Cinna. Now, Metellus.
Caesar.
What, Trebonius? I have an hour's talk in store for you. Remember that you call on me today. Be near me that I may remember you.
Caesar, I will.
He bows and steps away. Caesar starts out with the senators. Trebonius, lagging behind, turns to Brutus.
And so near will I be that your best friend shall wish I had been further.
They exit.
leaving Calpurnia alone. Act 3, Scene 1. The Capitol. Caesar and other officials have not yet entered, but the fore stage is crowded with people. Drawn apart from the others is the old teacher of rhetoric, Artemidorus. He holds a paper, reading its message to himself.
Caesar, beware of Brutus. Take heed of Cassius. Come not near Casca. Have an eye to Cinna. Trust not Trebonius. Mark well Metellus Cimber. Decius Brutus loves thee not. Thou hast wronged Caius Ligarius. There is but one mind in all these men, and it is bent against Caesar. If thou beest not immortal, look about you. Security gives way to conspiracy. The mighty gods defend thee, thy lover Artemidorus. Here will I stand till Caesar pass along, and as a suitor I will give him this. If thou read this, O Caesar, thou mayest live.
Hail Caesar!
Enter Caesar with Mark Antony, Publius, Papilius, and the conspirators. Passing through the crowd, he is confronted suddenly by the soothsayer.
The Ides of March are come.
Aye, Caesar, but not gone.
Caesar turns away with a wave of dismissal. Artemidorus presses forward.
Hail Caesar, read this schedule.
Decius brushes him aside.
Trebonius doth desire you to all read at your best leisure this, his humble suit.
Oh, Caesar, read mine first. For mine's a suit that toucheth Caesar nearer. Read it, great Caesar.
What touches us ourselves shall be last, sir.
Delay not, Caesar. Read it instantly.
What is the fellow mad?
Sirrah, give place.
He pushes the old man out of Caesar's way. Caesar mounts the steps to his chair and sits down. Papilius comes over to Cassius.
I wish your enterprise today may thrive.
What enterprise, Papilius?
Fare you well.
Papilius goes up the steps to Caesar.
What said Papilius, Lena?
You wish today our enterprise might thrive. I fear our purpose is discover it.
Look, high makes to Caesar. Mark him.
Casca, be sudden. We fear prevention.
Cassius, be constant. Papilius Lena speaks not of our purposes, for look, he smiles, and Caesar doth not change.
Trebonius knows his time, for look, you Brutus, he draws Mark Antony out of the way. Exit Antony and Trebonius.
Where is Metellus Cimber? Let him go and presently prefer his suit to Caesar.
He is addressed. Press near and second him.
Decius leaves them, going up to Caesar.
Casca, you are the first that rears your hand.
Are we all ready? What is now amiss that Caesar and his Senate must redress?
Most high, most mighty, and most puissant Caesar, Metellus Cimber throws before thy feet and humble heart.
I must prevent thee, Cimber. Thy brother by decree is banished. If thou dost bend and pray and fawn for him, I spurn thee like a cur out of my way. No, Caesar doth not wrong, nor without cause will he be satisfied.
Is there no voice more worthy than my own to sound more sweetly in great Caesar's ear for the repealing of my banished brother?
I kiss thy hand, but not in flattery, Caesar, desiring thee that Publius Cimber may have an immediate freedom of repeal.
What, Brutus?
Pardon, Caesar. Caesar, pardon. As low as to thy foot doth Cassius fall to beg enfranchisement for Publius Cimber. Casca is standing behind Caesar. From the folds of his cloak, he brings out a short Roman sword.
I could be well moved if I were as you. If I could pray to move, prayers would move me. But I am constant as the northern star, of whose true fixed and resting quality there is no fellow in the firmament. The skies are painted with unnumbered sparks. They are all fire, and every one doth shine. But there's but one in all doth hold his place. So in the world, 'tis furnished well with men, and men are flesh and blood and apprehensive. Yet in the number I do know but one that unassailable holds on his rank unshaked of motion, and that I am he. Let me a little show it, even in this. That I was constant, Cimber should be banished, and constant do remain to keep him so.
Oh,
hence wilt thou lift up Olympus?
Speak hands for me!
Casca rings down the sword, stabbing Caesar in the back. Caesar wheels about and Decius stabs him. A few of the braver citizens start up the steps in defense, but by this time all the conspirators have brought out swords. They menace the others with them, and most of the people fly out of the room. Caesar, roaring furiously, throws himself at Cassius, who triumphantly runs him through. One by one, the conspirators all thrust at him. Caesar, scarcely able to move, staggers down the steps and drags himself painfully up to Brutus, one hand stretched out to him in appeal. Averting his face, Brutus stabs him.
Tu, Brute.
Then fall, Caesar.
He falls to the floor, dead.
liberty. Freedom! Tyranny is dead! Run hence, proclaim, cry it about the streets. Come to the common pulpits and cry out, liberty, freedom, and enfranchisement.
People and senators, be not affrighted. Fly not, stand still. Ambition's debt is paid.
Go to the pulpit, Brutus.
And Cassius, too.
Where's Publius?
Here, quite confounded with this mutiny.
Stand fast together, lest some friend of Caesar's should chance.
Talk not of standing.
As Publius leaves, Brutus calls out to him.
Publius, good cheer. There is no harm intended to your person, not to no Roman else. So tell them, Publius.
Re-enter Trebonius. Where's Antony?
Fled to his house of maize. Men, wives, and children stare, cry out, and run as it were doomsday.
Fates, we will know your pleasures. That we shall die, we know. Tis but the time and drawing days out that men stand upon.
Why, he that cuts off 20 years of death cuts off so many years of fearing death.
Grant that, and then is death a benefit. So are we Caesar's friends that have abridged his time of fearing death. Stoop, Roman, stoop, and let us bathe our hands in Caesar's blood up to the elbows and besmear our swords. Then walk we forth, even to the marketplace, and waving our red weapons o'er our heads, let's all cry, peace, freedom, and liberty.
Stoop, then, and wash. How many ages hence shall this our lofty scene be acted over? In states unborn, and accents yet unknown.
How many times shall Caesar bleed in sport that now on Pompey's basis lies along, no worthier than the dust?
So oft as that shall be, so often shall the knot of us be called the men that gave their country liberty. Enter a servant to Mark Antony.
Soft, who comes here?
A friend of Antony's.
Thus, Brutus, did my master bid me kneel. Thus did Mark Antony bid me fall down. Being prostrate, thus he bade me say, Brutus is noble, wise, valiant, and honest. Caesar was mighty, bold, royal, and loving. Say I love Brutus, and I honor him. Say I feared Caesar, honored him, and loved him. If Brutus will vouchsafe that Antony may safely come to him, and be resolved how Caesar hath deserved to lie in death, Mark Antony shall not love Caesar dead so well as Brutus living. So says my master Antony.
My master is a wise and valiant Roman. I never thought him worse. Tell him, so please him come unto this place. He shall be satisfied. And by my honor, depart untouched.
I'll fetch him presently.
Exit the servant.
I know that we shall have him well to friend.
I wish we may. But yet have I a mind that fears him much. But here comes Antony. Mark Antony is standing in the entrance. Welcome, Mark Antony. Antony salutes them in silence. Then, catching sight of Caesar, he throws himself before the corpse.
Oh, mighty Caesar, dost thou lie so low? Are all thy conquests, glories, triumphs, spoils, shrunk to this little measure? Fare thee well.
He rises and faces the conspirators. I know not, gentlemen, what you intend. Who else must be let blood? Who else is rank? If I myself, there is no hour so fit as Caesar's death hour, nor no instrument of half that worth as those your swords, made rich with the most noble blood of all the world. I do beseech you, if you bear me hard, now, whilst your purpled hands do reek and smoke, fulfill your pleasure. Live 1,000 years, I shall not find myself so apt to die. No place will please me so. No mean of death is here by Caesar. And by you cut off, the choice and master spirits of this age.
Oh, Antony, beg not your death of us. Though now we must appear bloody and cruel, our hearts you see not. They are pitiful, and pity to the general wrong of Rome. As fire drives out fire, so pity, pity hath done this deed on Caesar. For your part, to you our swords have leaden points, Mark Antony.
Your voice shall be as strong as any man's in the disposing of new dignities.
Only be patient till we have appeased the multitude beside themselves with fear, and then we will deliver you the cause why I, that did love Caesar when I struck him, have thus proceeded.
I doubt not of your wisdom. Let each man render me his bloody hand. Friends, am I with you all, and love you all upon this hope,
that you shall give me reasons why and wherein Caesar was dangerous.
Or else were this a savage spectacle? Our reasons are so full of good regard that were you, Antony, the son of Caesar, you should be satisfied.
That's all I seek. And am moreover suitor that I may produce his body to the marketplace and in the pulpit, as becomes a friend, speak in the order of his funeral.
You shall, Mark Antony.
Brutus, a word with you. He takes him aside. You know not what you do. Do not consent that Antony speak in his funeral. Know you how much the people may be moved by that which he will utter?
By your pardon, I will myself into the pulpit first and show the reason of our Caesar's death.
Returning to the others.
Mark Antony, here, take you Caesar's body. You shall not in your funeral speech blame us, but speak all good you can devise of Caesar and say you do it by our permission. Else shall you not have any hand at all about his funeral. And you shall speak in the same pulpit whereto I am going after my speech is ended.
Be it so. I do desire no more.
Prepare the body, then, and follow us.
Mark Antony watches them go, then turning back to Caesar's corpse, he falls on his knee before it.
Oh, pardon me, thou bleeding piece of earth, but I am meek and gentle with these butchers. Thou art the ruins of the noblest man that ever lived in the tide of time. Woe to the hand that shed this costly blood. Over thy wounds, now do I prophesy, a curse shall light upon the limbs of men. Domestic fury and fierce civil strife shall cumber all the parts of Italy. Blood and destruction shall be so in use, and dreadful objects so familiar, that mothers shall but smile when they behold their infants quartered with the hands of war, all pity choked with custom of fell deeds. And Caesar's spirit, ranging for revenge with Ate by his side, come hot from hell, shall in these confines, with a monarch's voice, cry havoc, and let slip the dogs of war.
Act 3, Scene 2, The Forum. Brutus and Cassius are a little apart from the mob, talking together.
Audience. Cassius, go you into the other street and part the numbers. Those that will hear me speak, let them stay here. Those that will follow Cassius, go with him. And public reason shall be rendered of Caesar's death.
I will hear Brutus speak. I will hear Cassius and compare their reasons when suddenly we hear them rendered.
Cassius goes off, followed by a part of the throng. Brutus mounts to the pulpit.
Be patient till the last. Romans, countrymen, and lovers, hear me for my cause, and be silent that you may hear. Believe me for mine honor, and have respect to mine honor that you may believe. Censure me in your wisdom, and awake your senses that you may the better judge. If there be any in this assembly, any dear friend of Caesar's, to him I say that Brutus's love to Caesar was no less than his. If then that friend demand why Brutus rose against Caesar, this is my answer. Not that I loved Caesar less, but that I loved Rome more. Had you rather Caesar were living and die all slaves than that Caesar were dead to live all free men? As Caesar loved me, I weep for him. As he was fortunate, I rejoice at it. As he was valiant, I honor him. But as he was ambitious, I slew him. There is tears for his love, joy for his fortune, honor for his valor, and death for his ambition. Who is here so base that would be a bondman? If any, speak, for him have I offended. Who is here so rude that would not be a Roman? If any, speak, for him have I offended. Who is here so vile that will not love his country? If any, speak, For him have I offended. I pause for a reply.
None.
Then none have I offended. I have done no more to Caesar than you shall do to Brutus. The question of his death is enrolled in the Capitol.
Enter Mark Antony. After him come attendants bearing Caesar's body covered over with a cloak.
Here comes his body, mourned by Mark Antony, who, though he had no hand in his death, shall receive the benefit of his dying, a place in the Commonwealth, as which of you shall not? With this I depart, that as I slew my best lover for the good of Rome, I have the same dagger for myself, when it shall please my country to need my death.
Live, Brutus!
Live! Live. Live.
Bring him his triumph, fall into his house!
Give him a statue with an ancestor!
Let him be Caesar!
Caesar's better part shall be crowned in Brutus.
We'll bring him to his house with shouts and clamor.
My countrymen!
Silence! Brutus, speak!
Good countrymen! Let me depart alone, and for my sake, stay here with Antony. Do grace to Caesar's corpse and grace his speech, tending to Caesar's glories, which Mark Antony, by our permission, is allowed to make. I do entreat you, not a man depart, save I alone, till Antony have spoke.
The crowd parts to give him way. Exit Brutus.
Say, oh, let him go!
For
Brutus' sake, he finds himself beholding to us all.
Where best he speak,
the
harm of Brutus here?
Caesar was a tyrant!
We are blessed Romans, rid of him!
You gentle Romans!
Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him. The evil that men do lives after them. The good is oft interred with their bones. So let it be with Caesar. The noble Brutus has told you Caesar was ambitious. If it were so, it was a grievous fault, and grievously hath Caesar answered it. Here under leave of Brutus and the rest, for Brutus is an honorable man, so are they all honorable men, come I to speak in Caesar's funeral. He was my friend, faithful and just to me. But Brutus says he was ambitious, and Brutus is an honorable man. He hath brought many captives home to Rome, whose ransoms did the general coffers fill. Did this in Caesar seem ambitious? When that the poor have cried, Caesar hath wept, ambition should be made of sterner stuff. Yet Brutus says he was ambitious, and Brutus is an honorable man. You all did Caesar on the Lupercal. I thrice presented him a kingly crown, which he did thrice refuse. Was this ambition? Yet Brutus says he was ambitious, and sure he is an honorable man. I speak not to disprove what Brutus spoke, but here I am to speak what I do know. You all did love him once, not without cause. What cause withholds you then to mourn for him? Oh, judgment! Thou art fled to brutish beasts, and men have lost their reason. Bear with me. My heart is in the coffin there with Caesar, and I must pause till it come back to me.
Antony turns away. There is a silence. Then the first citizen says to his neighbor,
methinks there is much reason in his saying.
If thou consider rightly the matter, Caesar has had great wrong.
As he masters, I fear there will a worse come in his place.
But he is worse, he would not take the crown, therefore this certainly was not ambitious.
If it be bound so, some will dearer by this.
Poor soul, his eyes are red as fire with weeping.
There's not a nobler man in Rome than Antony.
Now march him.
He begins again to speak.
But yesterday, the word of Caesar might have stood against the world. Now lies he there, and none so poor to do him reverence. Oh, masters, if I were disposed to stir your hearts and minds to mutiny and rage, I should do Brutus wrong and Cassius wrong, who you all know are honorable men. I will not do them wrong. I rather choose to wrong the dead, to wrong myself and you, than I will wrong such honorable men.
But here's a parchment with the seal of Caesar. I found it in his closet. 'Tis his will. Let but the commons hear this testament, which, pardon me, I do not mean to read, and they would go and kiss dead Caesar's wounds and dip their napkins in his sacred blood, yea, beg a hair of him for memory, and dying, mention it within their wills, bequeathing it as a rich legacy unto their issue.
We hear the will! Read it, Mark Antony!
Have patience, gentle friends! I must not read it. It is not meet you know how Caesar loved you. You are not wood, you are not stones, but men. And being men, hearing the will of Caesar, it will inflame you. It will make you mad. 'Tis good you know not you are his heirs.
Read the will, we'll hear it, Antony.
Will you be patient? Will you stay a while? I have o'ershot myself to tell you of it. I fear I wrong the honorable men whose daggers have stabbed Caesar. I do fear it. You will compel me then to read the will? Then make a ring about the corpse of Caesar, and let me show you him that made the will. Shall I descend, and will you give me leave? Antony comes down the steps. Nay, press not so upon me. Stand far off. Antony is standing directly over Caesar's bier. If you have tears, prepare to shed them now. You all do know this mantle. I remember the first time ever Caesar put it on. It was on a summer's evening in his tent. That day he overcame the Nervii. Look, in this place ran Cassius' dagger through. See what a rent the envious Casca made. Through this, the well-beloved Brutus stabbed. And as he plucked his cursed steel away, mark how the blood of Caesar followed it, as rushing out of doors to be resolved if Brutus so unkindly knocked, or no. For Brutus, as you know, was Caesar's angel. Judge, O you gods, how dearly Caesar loved him. This was the most unkindest cut of all. For when the noble Caesar saw him stab, ingratitude, more strong than traitor's arms, quite vanquished him, then burst his mighty heart. And in his mantle, muffling up his face even at the base of Pompey's statue, which all the while ran blood, great Caesar fell. What a fall was there, my countrymen. Then I and you and all of us fell down whilst bloody treason flourished over us. Oh, now you weep. And I perceive you feel a dint of pity. These are gracious drops. Kind souls, what weep you when you but behold our Caesar's vesture wounded? Look you here. Here is himself. Marred, as you see, with traitors. Stay, countrymen! Good friends! Sweet friends, let me not stir you up to such a sudden flood of mutiny. They that have done this deed are honorable. What private griefs they have, alas, I know not what made them do it. They are wise and honorable, and will no doubt with reasons answer you. I come not, friends, to steal away your hearts. I am no orator, as Brutus is, but as you know me all, a plain blunt man. I tell you that which you yourselves do know. Show you sweet Caesar's wounds, poor, poor, dumb mouths, and bid them speak for me. But were I Brutus and Brutus Antony, there were an Antony would ruffle up your spirits and put a tongue in every wound of Caesar that should move the stones of Rome to rise and mutiny. Yet hear me, countrymen, yet hear me speak. Why, friends, you go to do you know not what. Wherein hath Caesar thus deserved your loves? Alas, you know not. I must tell you then. You have forgot the will I told you of.
The will? Let's see it! The
will! Here is the will. And under Caesar's seal to every Roman citizen he gives, to every several man, 75 drachmas. Hear me with patience. Moreover, he hath left you all his walks, his private arbors and new planted orchards on this side Tiber.
He hath left them you and your heirs forever, common pleasures to walk abroad and recreate yourselves. Here was a Caesar. When comes such another?
Never! Never!
We'll burn his body in the holy place and with the brand fire the house of his place.
Take up the body!
Go fetch fire!
Look down, Vengeance!
Look down, Form!
Antony is alone. In a while, the sky over the city starts to glow red.
Now let it work. Mischief. Thou art afoot. Take thou what course thou wilt.
A servant comes running in. Antony descends from the pulpit and goes up to him.
How now, fellow?
Sir, Octavius has already come to Rome.
Where is he?
He and Lepidus are at Caesar's house.
And thither will I straight to visit him. He comes upon a wish. Fortune is merry, and in this mood will give us anything.
I heard him say, Brutus and Cassius are rid like madmen through the gates of Rome.
Belike they had some notice of the people, how I had moved them. Bring me to Octavius. Act 3, Scene 3. A street. Enter Cinna, a poet.
I dreamt tonight that I did feast with Caesar, and things unluckily charge my fantasy. I have no will to wander forth of doors, yet something leads me forth.
Enter a group of citizens. Some of them are carrying bludgeons, some of them are drunk. They halt before the poet, menacing.
What is your name?
Whither are you going?
Where do you dwell?
Are you a married man or a bachelor?
Answer every man directly.
Aye and briefly.
Aye and wisely.
Aye and truly.
What is my name? Whither am I going? Where do I dwell? Am I a married man or a bachelor? To answer every man directly and briefly, wisely and truly. Wisely, I say I am a bachelor. Directly, I am going to Caesar's funeral.
As a friend or enemy?
As a friend.
For your dwelling, briefly?
Briefly, I dwell by the capital.
Your name, sir, truly?
Truly, my name is Cinna. I am Cinna the poet. I am Cinna the poet.
Tear him for his bad verses.
I am not Cinna the conspirator.
It is no matter. His name's Cinna.
They close in on him.
Tear him.
Act 4, Scene 1, a house in Rome. Around a table sit the triumvirate. Antony, Octavius, and Lepidus. A list of names is spread out before them. These many then shall die. Their names are pricked.
Your brother too must die. Consent you, Lepidus?
I do consent.
Prick him down, Antony.
Upon condition Publius shall not live, who is your sister's son, Mark Antony.
He shall not live. Look, with a spot I damn him. But Lepidus, go you to Caesar's house. Fetch the will hither. And we shall determine how to cut off some charge in legacies.
What shall I find you here?
Or here or at the Capitol.
Exit Lepidus. This is a slight unmeritable man. Meet to be sent on errands. Is it fit the threefold world divided? He should stand one of the three to share it.
So you fought him.
Octavius, I have seen more days than you, and though we lay these honors on this man to ease ourselves of divers slanderous loads, he shall but bear them as the ass bears gold, to groan and sweat under the business.
You may do your will, but he's a tried and valiant soldier.
So is my horse, Octavius. And for that I do appoint him store of provender. Do not talk of him but as a property. And now, Octavius, listen great things. Brutus and Cassius are levying powers. We must straight make head. Therefore let our alliance be combined, our best friends made, our means stretched, and let us presently go sit in council how covert matters may be best disclosed. And open perils surest answered.
Let us do so, for we are at the stake, and bade about with many enemies. And some that smile have in their hearts, I fear, millions of mischiefs.
Act 4, Scene 2. Brutus' tent. Brutus sits at a table reading a book by lamplight. Lucius, his serving boy, stands guard at the door. Titinius and Lucilius of Brutus' army enter and salute.
What now, Titinius? Is Cassius near?
He is at hand.
A word, Titinius,
how he received you. Let me be resolved.
With courtesy and with respect enough, but not with such familiar instances, nor with such free and friendly conference as he hath used of old.
Thou hast described a hot friend cooling. Ever note, Lucilius, when love begins to sicken and decay, it useth an enforced ceremony. There are no tricks in plain and simple faith. Comes his army on?
They mean this night in Sardis to be quartered. The greater part, the horse and general, are come with Cassius.
Stand!
Hark, he has arrived.
Cassius, in full armor, with his servant Pindarus and certain of his staff, appear at the entrance.
Most noble brother, you have done me wrong.
Judge me, you gods. Wrong I mine enemies? And if not so, how should I wrong a brother?
Brutus, this sober form of yours hides wrongs, and when you do
Cassius,
them...
Cassius, be content. Speak your grief softly. I do know you well. Before the eyes of both our armies here, which should perceive nothing but love from us, let us not wrangle. Bid them move away.
Venerus, bid our commanders lead their charges off a little from this ground.
Tineus, do you the like, and let no man come to our tent till we have done our conference.
They all exit except Brutus and Cassius.
That you have wronged me doth appear in this. You have condemned and noted Lucius Pella for taking bribes here of the Sardians, wherein my letters, praying on his side because I knew the man, were slighted off.
You wronged yourself to write in such a case.
In such a time as this, it is not meet that every knight's offense should bear his comment.
Let me tell you, Cassius, you yourself are much condemned to have an itching palm to sell and mart your offices for gold to undeservers.
I am itching palm. You know that you are Brutus that speaks this. But by the gods, this speech were else your last.
The name of Cassius honors this corruption, and chastisement doth therefore hide his head.
Chastisement!
Remember March. The Ides of March, remember. Did not great Julius bleed for justice' sake? What villain touched his body that did stab, and not for justice? What shall one of us that struck the foremost man of all this world but for supporting robbers... Shall we now contaminate our fingers with base bribes and sell the mighty space of our large honors for so much trash as may be grasped thus? I had rather be a dog and bay the moon than such a Roman.
Brutus, bait not me. I'll not endure it. You forget yourself to hedge me in. I am a soldier, I. Older in practice, abler than yourself to make conditions.
Go to. You're not Cassius.
I am.
I say you are not.
Urge me no more. I shall forget myself. Have mind upon your health. Tempt me no farther.
Away, slight man.
Is possible? Must I endure all this?
All this? I more fret till your proud heart break. Must I observe you? Must I stand and crouch under your testy humor? By the gods, you shall digest the venom of your spleen, though it do split you. For from this day forth, I'll use you for my mirth. Yea, for my laughter when you're waspish.
Is it come to this?
You say you are a better soldier. Let it appear so. Make your vaunting true, and it shall please me well. For mine own part, I shall be glad to learn of noble men.
You wrong me every way. You wrong me, Brutus. I said an elder soldier, not a better. Did I say better?
If you did, I cannot.
When Caesar lived, he durst not thus have moved me.
Peace, peace. You durst not so have tempted him.
I durst not!
No.
What? Durst not tempt him?
For your life, you durst not.
Do not presume too much upon my love. I've made you that I shall be sorry for.
You have done that you should be sorry for. There is no terror, Cassius, in your threats. For I am armed so strong in honesty that they pass me by as the idle wind which I respect not. I did send to you for certain sums of gold which you denied me. For I can raise no money by vile means. By heaven, I had rather coin my heart and drop my blood for drachmas than to wring from the hard hands of peasants their vile trash by any indirection. I did send to you for gold to pay my legions, which you denied me. Was that done like Cassius? Could I have answered Caius Cassius so? When Marcus Brutus goes so covetous, be ready, gods, with all your thunderbolts. Dash him to pieces.
I denied you not.
You did.
I did not. He was but a fool that brought my answer back. Brutus hath writhed my heart. A friend should bear his friend's infirmities. But Brutus makes mine greater than they are.
I do not till you've practiced them on me.
You love me not.
I do not like your faults.
A friendly eye could never see such faults.
A flatterer's would not, though they do appear as huge as high Olympus.
Come, Antony and young Octavius, come. Revenge yourselves alone on Cassius. For Cassius is a weary of the world. hated by one he loves. Brave by his brother. Checked like a bondman, all his faults observed. Set in a notebook, learned and conned by rote to cast into my teeth. Ah, it could weep my spirit from mine eyes. There is my dagger. And here my naked breast. Within a heart dearer than Plutus mine, richer than gold. If that thou beast a Roman, take it forth. I that denied thee gold will give my heart. Strike as thou didst at Caesar. For I know when thou didst hate him worse, thou lovest him better than ever thou loved Cassius.
Sheathe your dagger. Be angry when you will. It shall have scope. Do what you will. Dishonor shall be humor. Oh, Cassius, you are yoked with a lamb that carries anger as the flint bears fire. Who much enforced it shows a hasty spark and straight is cold again.
Hath Cassius lived to be but mirth and laughter to his Brutus? When grief and blood ill-tempered vexeth him.
When I spoke that, I was ill-tempered too.
Do you confess so much? Give me your hand.
And my heart too.
Oh, Brutus.
What's the matter?
Have you not love enough to bear with me when that rash humor which my mother gave me makes me forgetful?
Yes, Cassius. And from henceforth, when you are over earnest with your Brutus, you think your mother chides and leave you so. Lucius, a bowl of wine.
Enter the serving boy.
I did not think you could have been so angry.
Cassius, I am sick of many griefs.
Of your philosophy, you make no use if you give place to accidental evils.
No man bears sorrow better. Portia is dead.
Huh? Portia?
She is dead.
How scaped I killing when I crossed you so? Upon what sickness?
Impatient of my absence and grief that young Octavius with Mark Antony have made themselves so strong. She fell distract and her attendants absent. Swallowed fire.
And died so?
Even so.
Oh, ye mortal gods.
Speak no more of her. Give me a bowl of wine. In this, I bury all unkindness, Cassius.
My heart is thirsty for that noble pledge. Fill, Lucius, till the wine o'erswell the cup. I cannot drink too much of Brutus' love. Two officers appear at the entrance.
Come in, Titinius. Welcome, good Messala. Now, sit we close about this taper here and call in question our necessities.
Portia, art thou gone?
No more, I pray you. Messala, I have here received letters that young Octavius and Mark Antony come down upon us with a mighty power, bending their expedition toward Philippi.
Myself have letters of the selfsame tenor.
Well, to our work alive. What do you think of marching to Philippi presently?
I do not think it good.
Your reason?
It is better that the enemy seek us. So shall he waste his means, weary his soldiers, doing himself offense, whilst we lying still are full of rest, defense and nimbleness.
Good reasons must of force give place to better. The people twixt Philippi and this ground do stand but in a forced affection, for they have grudged us contribution.
Hear me, good brother.
Under your pardon, you must note beside that we have tried the utmost of our friends. Our legions are brimful, our cause is ripe. The enemy increaseth every day. We at the height are ready to decline. There is a tide in the affairs of men, which, taken at the flood, leads unto fortune. Omitted, all the voyage of their life is bound in shallows and in miseries. On such a full sea are we now afloat, and we must take the current when it serves, or lose our ventures.
Then, with your will, go on. We'll along ourselves and meet them at Philippi.
The deep of night is crept upon our talk, and nature must obey necessity. There is no more to say?
No more. Good night. Early tomorrow will we rise and hence.
Lucius, my gown. Farewell, good Messala. Good night, Titinius.
Exit the two officers.
Noble, noble Cassius. Good night,
and good repose.
Oh, my dear brother. This was the nil beginning of the night. Never come such division between our souls. Let it not, Brutus.
Everything is well.
Good night, my lord.
Good night, good brother.
Exit Cassius. Lucius is holding Brutus' gown.
Give me the gown. Where is the instrument?
Here in the tent.
What? Thou speaks drowsily? Poor knave, I blame thee not. Thou art all watched. Canst thou hold up thy heavy eyes a while and touch thy instrument a strain or two?
Aye, my lord, and please you.
It does, my boy. I trouble thee too much, but thou art willing.
It is my duty, sir.
I should not urge thy duty past thy might. I know young blood look for a time of rest.
I have slept, my lord, already.
It was well done. And thou shalt sleep again. I will not hold thee long. If I do live, I will be good to thee.
La, la, la.
This is a sleepy tune. O murderous slumber, lace thou thy leaden mace upon my boy that plays thee music. Gentle knave, good night. I will not do thee so much wrong to wake thee. If thou dost nod, thou breakst thy instrument. I'll take it from thee.
He takes the lute from the boy and covers him with his cloak.
Good boy, good night.
Brutus returns to his chair and picks up a book.
Let me see. Not the leaf turned down where I left reading. Here it is, I think.
He starts to read. The light grows dim.
How ill this taper burns.
Turning in his chair to adjust the light, Brutus sees the ghost of Julius Caesar.
Who comes here? I think it is the weakness of mine eyes that shapes this monstrous apparition. Art thou some god, some angel, or some devil that makes my blood cold and my hair to stare? Speak to me, what thou art.
My evil spirit, Brutus.
Why comest thou?
To tell thee thou shalt see me at Philippi.
Now I have taken heart, thou vanishest. Ill spirit, I would hold more talk with thee.
Oh.
Boy, Lucius.
Lucius stirs in his sleep.
The strings, my lord, are falling.
Lucius, awake.
My lord.
Didst thou dream, Lucius, that thou so cried'st out?
My lord, I do not know that I did cry.
Yes. That thou didst. Didst thou see anything?
Nothing, my lord.
Go and commend me to my brother Cassius. Bid him set on his powers betimes before. And we will follow.
Act 5, Scene 1. The Plains of Philippi. Cassius enters, closely followed by Titinius.
Oh, look, Titinius. Look, the villains fly.
Oh, Cassius. Brutus gave the word too early. Who, having some advantage on Octavius, took it too eagerly. His soldiers fell despoiled, whilst we by Antony are all enclosed.
Enter Pindarus.
Fly further off, my lord. Fly further off. Mark Antony is in your tents, my lord. Fly now, our noble Cassius. Fly far off.
This hill is far enough. Look, look, Titinius. Are those my tents where I perceive the fire?
They are, my lord.
Titinius, if thou lovest me, mount thou my horse and hide thy spurs in him till he have brought thee up to yonder troops and here again. I may rest assured whether yon troops are friend or enemy.
I will be here again, even with a thought.
Exit Titinius.
Go, Pindarus, get higher on that hill. My sight was ever thick. Regard, Titinius, and tell me what thou knowest about the field.
Pindarus climbs the hill.
This day I breathed first. Time has come round. And where I did begin, there shall I end. My life is run as compass.
Oh, my lord!
What news?
Titinius is enclosed round about with horsemen that make Coelum on the spur. Yet he spurs on. Now they are almost on him. Now, Titinius! Now some light. Oh, he lies too. He's tired and hard. They shout for joy.
Come down, behold no more. Oh, coward that I am. To live so long. Come hither, sirrah. In Parthia did I take thee prisoner, and then I swore thee saving of thy life, that whatsoever I did bid thee do, thou shouldst attempt it. He urges a sword on him, hilt foremost. Come now,
Keep thine oath. Now be a free man. With this good sword that ran through Caesar's bowels, search this bosom. Stand not to answer. Here take thou the hilts. And when my face is covered, as it is now, guide thou the sword. Obediently, Pindarus stabs him, drawing the sword quickly away and stepping back. Cassius stares at it, and Pindarus lets it fall.
Caesar, thou art revenged, even with the sword that killed thee.
He drops to the ground, dead.
So, I am free. It would not so have been, durst I have done my will. O Cassius, far from this country Pindarus shall run, where never Roman shall take note of him.
Exit Pindarus. For a while the stage is empty, save for the dead body. Finally, from below come Brutus and certain of his followers, Messala, Cato, Clitus, Volumnius, and Strato.
Lo, yonder.
They go to the body, and Cato picks the mantle off Cassius' face.
He is slain.
O Julius Caesar, thou art mighty yet. Thy spirit walks abroad and turns our swords in our own proper entrails. The last of all the Romans, fare thee well. It is impossible that ever Rome should breed thy fellow. Friends, I owe more tears to this dead man than you shall see me pay. Come, poor remains of friends, rest on this rock.
Statilius showed the torchlight, but my lord, he came not back. He is or ta'en or slain.
Sit thee down, Clitus. Slaying is the word. It is a deed in fashion. Hark thee, Clitus.
He whispers in the ear of Clitus.
What?
I, my lord?
No. Not for all the world.
Peace, then. No words.
I'll rather kill myself.
Come hither, good Volumnius. Mr. Word.
What says my lord?
Why, this, Volumnius. The ghost of Caesar hath appeared to me. I know my hour has come.
Not so, my lord.
Nay, I'm sure it is, Volumnius. Thou seest the world, Volumnius, how it goes. Our enemies have beat us to the pit. It is more worthy to leap in ourselves than tarry till they push us. Good Volumnius, thou knowest that we two went to school together. Even for that our love of old, I prithee, hold thou my sword hilt whilst I run on it.
That's not an office for a friend, my lord.
Fly, fly, my lord! There is no tarrying here!
Farewell to you, and you, and you, Volumnius. Strato, thou hast been all this while asleep. Farewell to thee too, Strato. Countrymen, my heart doth joy that yet in all my life I found no man but he was true to me. I shall have glory by this losing day more than Octavius and Mark Antony by this vile conquest shall attain unto. So fare you well at once, for Brutus' tongue hath almost ended his life's history. Night hangs upon mine eyes. My bones would rest.
Fly, my lord, fly!
Hence, I will follow.
They all hurry off, except Strato.
Strato, thou art a fellow of a good respect. Thy life hath had some smatch of honor in it. Hold then my sword, and turn away thy face, while I do run upon it. Wilt thou, Strato?
Give me your hand first. Fare you well, my lord.
Strato levels the sword. Without a word, Brutus throws himself against it. Strato pulls out the sword and lets it fall. Brutus supports himself on his shoulder.
Farewell, good Strato.
Strato runs down the hill and away.
Caesar, now be still. I kill not thee with half so good a will.
He falls on his face and rolls over dead. The sound of fighting grows to a quick crescendo. Then the bugles blare, and on the crest of the hill appear Octavius and Mark Antony. Behind them rise the spears and standards of their army. They look down at the body at their feet. Octavius kneels.
So Brutus should be found.
Dusk has fallen over the plains. The army stands silent. This was the noblest Roman of them all. All the conspirators, save only he, did that they did in envy of great Caesar. He only, in a general honest thought and common good to all, made one of them. His life was gentle, and the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man.